Good morning.
Good morning.
Glad to see everybody this morning. Welcome to our visitors. Glad to have you. We make you feel at home here. Does anybody have any prayer requests?
My surgery is nice to have y'all get me in prayer for.
Officer member laid out, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
Can you believe that?
Amen.
Praise God, it's going to be good up here, isn't it?
Amen.
I've been thinking about it this week quite a bit, and looking forward to the day the trumpet sounds, are you?
Amen.
Amen. I'm so happy to be back with you again. Thank you for your kindness and the love that I feel in this place. And we just welcome the Holy Spirit to minister to us today and fill us with the goodness of God. Amen.
Amen.
I believe it's going to happen. It's already, I've already seen a great sign that He's here.
Yes,
He's working.
Here.
Praise God.
Oh,
what a great song you just had. Here we go. Pray for me as I try to do this one.
Bless the Lord.
Upon the mountain from where He ascended, and the angel of the Lord declared it would be. He said, "Don't stand here grieving, for the one that you see leaving in like manner's coming back for you and me."
Well, they tell me Jesus died for my transgression. And he paid that price a long, long time ago. He gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else that I want to know. Oh,
my problem.
Yes, amen.
It's good to have Sharon back with us at home. I mean.
Yeah.
You gotta say I'm good at this one.
Yeah.
I like that big old job over there. Let's have a good plan when somebody knows how they practice. Which I did, I don't want to. Feel the presence of the Lord in here, do you? Hallelujah. Clean my glasses, they were dirty. Forgive me. I want to go with Acts chapter 3. I'm not ready to go there yet, but I gotta talk to you. There's a lot of things going on in the world right now, and all of us need our eyes open. Need our heads held high. We don't need to be depressed. We don't need to be worried about what's going on around us, what our neighbors think, what our friends think, what our...
Amen.
Y'all forgive me. We don't need to worry about what our husbands or wives are thinking. We need to make sure that our mind is on the Lord. Because I believe He's soon coming, and I believe it's not going to be long. And I believe that we need to make sure that everything's in line. All these things that are going on, trying to cause Israel to fall and all these things, they don't realize this is bringing back Christ, but I'm so glad. I'm so glad we're going to be able to see Jesus so long. I believe that with all my heart. Pat will show me this morning where they're in the house, where they're trying to pass, where they do away with the New Testament to satisfy all these people in the world. And as I told you Wednesday night, I'm still willing to pay my part on the airplane to send them back wherever they want to go.
Amen.
Many trips we have to make them go there. If they want to be with the Hezbollah, let them be with the Hezbollah. I want to be with Jesus. Amen. Whether they believe it or not, He's coming. And I think that we need to keep our houses in order and make sure that we're ready to go. If you've got any question this morning of anything, if you've told the preacher a lie this morning, you have to pray over it.
Amen.
Somebody went in Sunday school class and missed that.
So I need to tell you again.
We will be y'all.
Thank you, sister.
I don't want anybody else to get blamed in this morning.
She was worried about killing something that's going to be in the New Testament, in the Revelations, that's going to be as big as horses. The locusts are going to be as big as horses. So if you kill one of them, maybe you might keep somebody from being stoned to death. I don't know. During tribulation, I don't know what's going to happen. But I tell you right now, if your house ain't where it's supposed to be, I'd say make sure that you get this old house in order. Make sure that you've got your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Make sure that everything is wonderful. It's good to have the sister with us this morning, Sister Tanya's mother.
Amen.
Ernestine. Ernest, meet Ernestine. We do have Ernest, but we didn't have Ernestine, right? It's good to have you this morning with us. I appreciate you. Good to have you too, Ernest. Praise God. You too, Jimmy. I ain't going to leave you out.
Just because she's here don't mean I'm going to act any different.
Mama, if you need help, I got a bill. Don't matter how old our kids get, we still can bring them back in line, can't we? Amen. I can talk to them just like if I always did. It don't bother me one bit. If I see something I need to be talking to them about, I do it. I try to do it nicely, but then if they don't listen to me nicely, then I try to do it in the daddy voice. And they don't want to hear that most of the time. But we are right at the birth of Jesus Christ, split the eastern sky. I believe that. The songs were good this morning. They all fell in line together with that. And I think it is not going to be long. And I think if this old world keeps going the way it's going, I don't want to live here no way. It's just getting wickeder every day. It's horrible to think about that. You can't walk up and down the streets in peace. You can't. Your car breaks down. You gotta have a gun in the console. I mean, it's terrible. It really is. I mean, we're there. I mean, we're right there right now. And I never thought that America or this little area here would ever be that way. But every week we see somebody's been killed. Somebody's been just here where the children are being abused. I don't know what I'd do. The teachers, we send them to a teacher. I seen where a 24-year-old woman this week that was a school teacher had a fifth grade boy and abused him. We've got problems. believe in God, our laws don't trust God. We make up all of these laws and put them on the books, but none of them are raising up Jesus. And we need to stand for Jesus. We need to see that Jesus is alive and well. We need to see that each and every one of us is needing this God working in and his prayer. I read this to you and preached this to you the other week, but I'm going further today. A little further today into this, and I want you to see some of the things that are going on in our world right now that Israel is having to go through. And I might not get into it as deep as I want to, but it's not only going to be Israel. As long as you call yourself a Christian, it's going to be us. We're going to go through things that are, they're going to try and destroy us. They don't want us holding this world together right now. The only thing that's holding this world together is not churches, but it's churches that believe in salvation and the Holy Ghost and the power of God. That's what's holding the world together
right
now. And I hope you know that there's a bunch of churches out here, but they're not holding the world together. But those that can pray and get a hold of God, those that can trust God and believe in God. And nowadays, people don't even believe whenever somebody says, well, I can pray and get a hold of God. They look at you and say, well, you don't look like you really can pray and get a hold of God. They don't even believe you. You know, it's unreal. And they don't understand that you don't have to look a certain way. You can be paralyzed. You can be sick. You can be in turmoil. But you can have God in your heart.
Amen.
And know that God is with you. And you can still give peace to somebody else. And they don't understand that. They think if everything's good with you, then everything's going to be perfect in your life. We're fighting the enemy. And he's called the devil. And he's got one of the imps that works with him. And they come against us and they try to destroy us. There's a man here that had been in a paralyzed position all his life. Laid at a gate. But he had never really met what he really needed. I want to pray for Israel. That's where I want to get around to at the end of this. And I want to give you a little layer for it. But I want you to realize they're paralyzed right now. I want you to see the scripture. They're paralyzed right now. Because their belief is not in the God that we're serving right now. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Their belief is in one God. And they think God's it. And there's not been a Redeemer that's come. Emmanuel. God with us. But we all know in here, every one of us is saved, and our name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. We know there's an Emmanuel, and God is with us. We know that God lives in us. We know that God leads us. We know that God guides us. We know that God raises us up. Whenever everything is going wrong, he's the one that lifts us up. Whenever everything in our life looks like it's down, he's the one that raises us up again. He's the one that keeps building us up. And that's what Israel's missing right now. They don't have that God with us. They've got a God that loves them and a God that cares for them, but they don't have enough belief in their heart to have God with them. And you see, that's where we've got the advantage right here in America right now, because God opened the door for the Gentile people.
Amen.
And God is with us now. God is anointing us now. God is blessing us now. He says there's coming a day he's going to take his hand off. And I believe that's not long. So you better enjoy what you felt this morning whenever you came in. We were praying for people, that shout, that enjoyment. Because if you're left behind, all that's going to be gone and turned back to Israel. Got to think about these things. That's what I want you to do this morning. Because this is where I'm headed. The Lord will. I've tarried with this message all week. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go in into the temple, asked an alms. He was not asking for healing. He was not asking for for anything but just a piece of money. That's what he wanted, was a piece of money. He wanted somebody to help him with a piece of money. He wanted someone to bless him with a piece of money. But he had went to some men that had something greater in their heart than money. He had went to some men that had something greater in their life than a few pieces of silver or gold or whatever it was. He went to a man that has the power of God. And Peter fastened his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk." Now wait a minute. Peter's going to give him something better than the alms that he's asking for. He's going to reach out his hand. And he's going to give him part of him. Whenever we come in here, sometimes we come in and we hug somebody or shake their hand. You ain't going to shake your hand. Shunning me this morning, brother. We're not just giving them a handshake. We're giving them the peace of God. Because whenever I left home, I've already prayed, have you? I've already saw God's face. I've already had the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the power of God move upon me. So whenever I reach out this hand, in the name of Jesus, I might be laughing, telling you a joke, but in the name of Jesus, I'm giving you the love. Because I love you. You see, that's what they were receiving. They were receiving the Lord. The man was. He was. Peter said, "Here, I want to read you just a little more here now, and then I'm going to go a little deeper." Then Peter said, "Silver and gold." Wait a minute, let me go back to 5. "And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, 'Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk.'" We'll read that one more time. "And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength." In our minds, we think that Peter gave him strength. Whenever we're up here praying, or if you go to some of these well-known preachers and they lay hands on you, we say, "Well, they give me the strength." All strength comes from God. We're just an instrument. We're just, some of us are ugly instruments and some of us are pretty instruments, but we're just an instrument. We're just something God can use. We're just something that God can fill the house. And whenever you lay hands on them and it's God's will, then that blessed assurance of God flows from you to me. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be a preacher. You don't have to be a Sunday school teacher. All you've got to do is know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and He can give you the gift to lay your hands on someone in them recovery. Remember all this. Because Israel has never accepted this. This man had really never accepted it. You say, "Well, again, they were going to the temple." Sure they were. Because there was people in that time that were coming to Christ. At times there were 5,000 that were coming to Christ. There was people that was flocking to see Christ. Today we might have 5, 1. And sometimes churches go years and years and never see a soul.
Amen.
Well, some words are another. If we were going years and years and never see a soul come to the altar, I believe I would have to move over to the side and say, "There's something wrong with me." Because I'm not letting God use me. Because there's people out here that are lost, and they're going to come to your church and they're going to receive. Maybe if you don't even know the word that well, maybe if you're not smart enough to speak the word that well, maybe you're not smart enough to read that well, God still has that anointing. And that anointing reaches out. It's like whenever somebody gets up here and sing, you can have people sing all day long. But if you have somebody that is anointed, then you have somebody that's anointed a little stronger. Then you have somebody with that anointing that flows. And then you have somebody that lets God use them. And then all of a sudden, everybody in the church feels that precious anointing.
Yes.
And that's what we need. We need this in the last days. I'm heading there, just hang on. This ain't no short message, I gotta get to it. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with the wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto them. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? I was listening to the news the other day. And I was in here in church the other Sunday bragging how God took all those bombs that came in at Israel, and he was able to collapse them up in the air. And then I heard this other man say that we have created the technology to do all these things. We have created the technology that can create a power that will heal them in the air miles away from us. And then I heard another Israelite over here say, if it wasn't for God, it only works 90% of the time. But the other 10% would have hit us. So God only took care of the 10%. God was fully in charge. You see, even though, and this is where America is right now. I can see this even with the Israelites. I can see it in America right now. Whenever God does a great miracle, whenever God blesses your home, and whenever God blesses us, a lot of times we try to wipe it away and we say, well, it just happened, or this just happened, or we've created so much things that we know how to handle it. I want to tell you something. No matter how great you think you are, no matter how big you think you are, no matter what you think you can do, there's a God in heaven that's leading and guiding you, and he's trying to take care of you, and he's trying to lead you to life forever. Hallelujah, glory to God. Hallelujah!
Yeah.
Glory!
Yeah.
Woo! Glory!
Yeah.
Glory.
Yeah.
Man couldn't walk. Well, Peter and John, they knew that. Peter and John knew they didn't heal him. They knew who healed him. You would think if somebody walked in here and they'd been paralyzed all their life and we laid hands on them and they recovered, you would think the whole church would explode. You would think everybody would believe God. And some would, don't get me wrong. But there's so many people that would be able to explain that away and say it never really happened the way it happened. Because the devil blinds the very elect in the last days. And that's what he's doing right now. He's blinding the very elect. I couldn't figure out how to put this before I'm going. So God had to give it to me. It took all week. My 13th. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of the fathers, hath glorified his Son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God had raised from the dead, whereof ye are witnesses, and this his name through faith, and his name hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know, yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Peter says, it's the one you killed. It's the one you destroyed. So when you took his life, he was trying to raise you up. Every time you walk out of this church and you deny God, you're doing the same thing. And then we wonder why Israel's under so much pressure. We wonder why. And we're praying for, and we're supposed to pray for them. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying quit praying for them. But we wonder why they're under so much pressure. We're wondering why everything's going wrong with them. It's because they won't believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And they're never going to be out from under that pressure until they believe it. Until they go up in that little place up in Petrie and they realize that Jesus is alive and well. They're never going to be able to serve God the way they need to. There's people that's going to come to church, and I hope it's none of you. And they're going to wonder, is Jesus really alive and well? They're going to wonder, is he still King of Kings and Lord of Lords? And they're going to die and go to hell because they will not believe. But God is trying to call us to salvation. God is trying to call us to his realm that we might serve him in the beauty of holiness. That we might reach up a hand and say, thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Peter said, hey, I didn't do it, but the Lord did it. He done it because he loved you. You might have killed him, but he still loves you. This man was sitting at the gate. We had church before we ever got in this sanctuary because God is with us. Ooh, that's good. Amen. Verse 17. And now, brethren, I brought that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers. I don't know whether you call ignorance today or not for Israel. Most of the Jews still don't believe. I don't know whether it's ignorance now or not, or it's just blasphemy. Or it's just turning from God. Well, what do you call it today? I wrestled with this week because I wanted to call it something. I wanted to be able to say it's because Jesus walked upon their land. It's because they didn't get to see him. It's because of the Pharisees. Now thought about it. We have Pharisees here in the church. In every church, there's a Pharisee somewhere. Maybe not today, I don't know. That'll be their home today. But you know what I'm talking about. There's Pharisees. That does not cause me not to serve God.
Amen.
That does not cause me to say I'm not going to serve Jesus. Because somebody else says there's no God. Because somebody else says he's not real. That's not going to cause me not to want to go to heaven. There is a God in heaven, and I don't understand why the Jews can't see it. I know they have went through things. And I was thinking back of all the things they went through. You know, they were set free in 1948. That's before I was born. But they were set free. And if they would have put God first in their life, you're talking about a place. You're talking about a place that if you could go and feel the presence of the Holy Ghost and the power of God, it would have been there. They enjoyed the freedom, but they want the freedom at their own cost. Okay, well, then I thought about that. And I couldn't figure out how to say what. Then I thought, ain't that what America's doing right now? Don't they want the freedom?
freedom at their own cost. These young people that's out here marching and saying, you know, Hezbollah, you know, and all of these things, they're putting down Israel, they're putting down the Christian. Are they saying that we're going to have it our way? This ain't Burger King, this is America.
Amen.
And I ain't going to give it to them their way. I'm going to pray for their souls. And they ain't going to like that. Because whenever you pray for their soul, it gets them upset. You say, well, Ken, that might be, it could have been some of your kids or whatever. I don't care whose kids it is. Mine, yours, or whoever. They need Jesus. Israel needs Jesus right now. They need it more than they need anything else. The people here didn't want to serve Jesus. They didn't want to give Jesus their heart. Even after this man comes walking through the temple, leaping and praising God, they still couldn't understand how Jesus could be real. The man had been there all his life. They had seen him every time they walked through to the gate. They'd seen the man sitting there begging alms. But Jesus reached down and gave him what he needed through Peter and John. All they said was, fasten your eyes on me. And praise God in the name of Jesus. And that holy anointing just jumped off into his legs. But they look for every excuse. Just like we do. Brother Ken, now you going to get me. Every time God calls us to get closer. Every time God tells us that if we stay in church, we're getting strong in the Lord. You know what I see a lot of times? People come to church and they start getting strong in the Lord, and the first thing they do is try to find some excuse to get away from God. So how are you going to blame it all on the Jews? Because praise God, it's right here in America. It's on us. We're denying Jesus. We're denying Jesus. Every time we're pushing him down, every time we're taking our foot and saying, don't raise that head up, Jesus, because we don't want you in here. We want to serve and we want your blessings, but we don't want you telling us how to walk and how to live and how to bless us. We want to hold you down a little bit. That's what churches are doing today. Because you go into a church and you preach the gospel that you know sin is sin and sin will send you to hell, and they'll run you out. They don't want to hear that. They want you to tell them that sin is forgiven and God is a forgiving God and He'll forgive you and you're going to go to heaven. There ain't nobody died in the last 10 years that went to heaven. If you go to the funeral, everybody's in heaven. They might have been a drunk, they might have been a drug addict, they might have been a devil, but they in heaven. Somebody's going to hell in the last 10 years, let me tell you. That's because they didn't serve God. Because they didn't put God first. And then you say, Brother Keith, you're the preacher. You got to build up the Spirit and all the other people. Well, I want to build up the Spirit and all the other people. But those people that lay before you need to live before God to go to heaven. The Jews have got to live before God to go to heaven. They've got to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Oh, glory. But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all the prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, and that your sins may be blotted out when the time comes of refreshment shall come from the presence of the Lord. Is that not what I just explain to you in my own terms? And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive unto the times of the restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the word began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall ye swear in all the things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear the prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed, until the first God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you, in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. And as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. See, now whenever you get preaching the resurrection from the dead, it ruffles feathers. The Jews still believe whenever they die, they lay in a grave. And they don't go to heaven. But the New Testament, and if we, and if the government gets away and do away with the New Testament, and we don't stand for it the way they're trying to, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that's what I base my life upon. Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. Be absent from the body and be present with him. That's where I stand. It's concrete. And if they take that away from us, or they try to take that away from us, Brother King, you wouldn't fight for it. I'd fight for it in a minute. Because that is exactly what God has promised to every one of his children. I can come in here and be crippled, and y'all can push me around in a wheelchair, and I can still preach. But you take away the gospel, and you take away the resurrection, I ain't got nothing to preach about. I might as well go home and close my book and go into my room and say, I'm done. Because we, somewhere or another, are going to have to stand up. The Jews have stood up for what they believe in, and it's going to cost them at the end. During tribulation, and then God's going to come back and he's going to take care of them. But I can tell you right now, you and I, they don't realize Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords while they're up there in that place. They don't realize it. They don't realize it. But during that time of tribulation, those people that are left behind, those people that don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, on this side of the world, with angels in it. After you've taken the mark of the beast, in your forehead, palm of your hand, or the back of your hand, wherever they put it, it's a grim one. How are they going to know? Sorry. We won't fuss at you the first time. How in the world are they going to stand the things that are coming upon this earth whenever they can't come to an altar right now and accept Jesus as a personal Savior? Been paralyzed in your legs, been paralyzed in one of your arms. Praise God, you couldn't talk, couldn't see. That's just a condition. But maybe you're blind in the spirit. That's pure hate. That's pure hate. Peter and John, give this man his legs, give him strength. Through Jesus Christ. Church, I say unto you this morning, this is deep in my heart. I hope you know this. This is deep in my heart because I feel like we're so close to Jesus walking through the door and saying, enough's enough. Enough's enough. And there's still people playing church.
live without all the monies that I want. I can live with all the things that I want. But I can't live without Jesus. The Spirit of God was on the outside of the church that morning. The anointed was on the outside. And I'd like to be able to read the rest of it, but as we go into it, every Pharisee that was there despised what happened on the outside of that gate. Every unbeliever despised what happened on the outside of that gate. Whenever that man came into the temple and was running, leaping, and praising God, it disgusted them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. I've been in churches where there were men called a minister, and other young men would get upset because God didn't call them, and they would leave the church and never come back. At one time I said they could have my calling. God says, call them without repentance, so I couldn't give it to them. I've been in churches whenever people think they really love God and so further slain from the line. They're not looking for Him. They're not ready for Him. This is my home. This is my house. I live at 1087 Jerusalem Road. There ain't nobody coming in my house drinking, drugging. I don't care if it's my children or my wife's children. They ain't coming in there drinking and drugging. I used to be a terrible person. I'd never done drugs, but I'd done the other. And I went in my home. But my home is sanctified now.
Amen. Amen.
And I kicked the devil out of it. And I'm not going to live in hell for nobody. I'm going to live on this side of heaven, but Jesus is going to be with me. I might go through hell and things in my life. Listen to me now. I'm serious this morning. I'm telling you the truth. I might go through hell of things that's happening along the way, but it ain't going to come in my house. There's a line to be drawn. There's a line to be drawn. And praise God, you can't come across this line with this in my house. No way. If you want to come here, then you come in, and you come in with the presence of the Holy Ghost and the power of God on you, or either you can come in and we can sit down and we can talk whether you love the Lord or not. But then again, I'm not going to let you disturb the God that's in my home. This is my release. This is my relief. Between there and my barn, whenever I could walk good, brother, I could walk over to the barn and I could get up a little feed to feed them cows. And there was such a holy relief. Just me and God. I don't know how you explain it to somebody. But it was like peace. Probably didn't feed you goat, you feel the same thing. Probably didn't feed you chicken, you feel the same. There's something about it. There's a holy relief. The devil took that away from me whenever he gave me COVID because I couldn't walk to the barn. But I'm serving notice on him this morning.
Yes,
he better get on me real quick because God's on me now and the anointing's on me. Yes. And I think I can get to the barn now. Yes. And I'm getting ready to put something over where I can find my relief. I'm going to find me some relief. Israel could have relief if they would bow on their knees and cry out to Jesus. Church, you could have relief this morning if you're not doing it. Falling on your knees and crying out to Jesus. Because He's here. He'll bless you. He loves you. The only person that can make the decisions in your life are you. And I pray that every one of you make the right decision. Every one of you make the right decision for your life. Make sure that you have a place to go find peace. I don't know where it's going to be at. You might not even be in your home right now. You might have to get you a, what do they call them, she sheds?
Yes.
She sheds. You might get you a she shed to go and get along with Christ. Or a he shed, maybe you need a he shed. But Jesus is coming. And we'd better make up our mind whom we're going to serve. Whom we're going to serve. The Jews have sort of made up their minds right now, but it's coming upon them that they're going to have a longer chance than we are. You see, whenever they're going up into that little rock, open cave, they're not going to get up there easy. There's going to be somebody trying to kill them. Probably some of them will lose their lives. Maybe never accept Jesus. You know what? You got an opportunity this morning, every one of you, to be able to bow at an altar and cry out to God and say, Lord, whatever I need in my life, whatever it may be, whatever I need, God, I want you to be the author and the finisher. And if we'll do that, if we'll be that honest with God, every one of us that's sitting in here this morning, God's going to anoint us. He's going to bless us. He's going to give us all we need. Stand with me. Let's talk with you there to remember. Don't worry about it. Don't feel about it. I love you this morning. I'm not done with this message. I want you to know that it goes deeper than that. I want every one of you to inventory you. Make sure that your name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. The Bible says this is a no-so salvation. There's no question. No. What's the baddest? The hard shell, but the primitive baddest. They say they believe just like this. They believe that I'm going to hope that I make it to water. And they say, I hope that I'm going to make it to heaven. That ain't what the Bible says. I ain't kicking out the denomination. What I'm trying to say is they missed the mark. Because this is a no-so salvation. You ain't got to call up and ask your brother or your sister, am I going to make it to heaven? You ain't got to ask your wife or your husband, am I going to make it to heaven? You ain't got to call your children, because you don't know. There's something different in that heart. It's going to take you to heaven. Whenever Peter and John stuck out that hand, they didn't just give that man a hand. They gave him Jesus Christ. And all that filled the heart, the legs, and the body. Hallelujah. You need to pray this morning. The altar's open. Won't you come? Won't you come? The altar's open. You're welcome to come. Dear Heavenly Fathers, we come to you this morning, God. I ask, Lord, that you let each and every one that's here, Lord, take this message, God, and fit it to the heart. God, I know I tarried with it all week, God. God, I haven't brought it justice this morning, God. But God, I know, Lord, that there's enough here that I can bring it back, God, and I can show them, Lord, what you've done and how blessed you are, God, and the things that the people try to keep and hide from what they really need in their life. And God, I'm asking you right now, Lord, if there be one here this morning that's not assured where they're going to spend eternity, they're not assured that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, if they're not assured that their name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, I beg you, Lord, don't let them go through that door. But let them come to this altar and call upon you and receive you. Lord, don't let them be rolled in here in a casket and have to be stood before and not know where they're going. But God, give them that assurance. Let them know that you are King of kings and Lord of lords. And you're Lord of their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's good to have you this morning. It's good to have time.